support our role models to make this event possible. Particularly, I do want to reiterate my sincere thanks to the President Dr. Fakulfuri and Dean and the Shea, as well as, of course, to our beloved Professor Hussein and Dr. Makran Rabah. My heartfelt thanks must go also to our beloved alma mater, the AUE, Women's Club leadership, forever insisting on remaining a hub of academic freedom, open dialogue, and unwavering respect for diversity. Allow me first to introduce briefly Professor Engin Akarli, on whose behalf I have the honor to read today. Professor Akarli is Professor of History at Istanbul Şehir University and Tchaikovsky Family Distinguished Professor Emeritus of Modern Middle East History at Brown University. He studied at Robbins College for his BA in Economics and Business, University of Wisconsin, where he received his MA in History in 1972, and Bristol University, where he received his PhD in Near East Studies, as well as an MA in Near East Studies in 1973 and 1976, respectively. He taught at Princeton University, 1975 and 76, Boğaziçi University of Oxford, 1976 to 1983, Yarmouk University in Jordan, 1983 to 1989, the Washington University in St. Louis, 1989 to 1996, before he joined Brown University. He was research fellow at Wissenschafts College zu Berlin, I don't know if I pronounced that correctly, 1985 to 1986, National Endowment of the Humanities fellow at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, a research fellow at the Islamic Legal Studies program of Harvard Law and School. Law School and Fulbright Senior Scholar in 2011-2012. His publications include The Long Peace, Ottoman Netherlands, 1861-1920, published in 1993, Belgeler in Tanzimat, 1977, Political Participation in Turkey, 1974, and numerous articles on 19th century Ottoman history and Ottoman legal history. He serves on the Board of Advisors of Islamic Law and Society, Journal of Turkish Legal History, Journal of Ottoman Studies, Journal of Cyprus Studies, at the Center for Turkish Studies of the Foundation for Arts and Learning in Istanbul. It is our great pleasure to have Professor Engin. He's joining me globally. I will now shift persona gratis and assume the honor of reading his paper. The paper he presented entitled Glimpses of Druze History, Preservation of Dignity and Community in Oneness with Humanity. The formation of elaborate state organizations sustained by and ideally serving an economically, politically, and culturally integrated body of citizens has been one of the most distinctive challenges of the modern era. The efforts to meet this challenge of becoming a modern nation state have been fizzled down to concentration of power in the hands of autocratic oligarchies in the Middle East, as in many parts of the world. These regimes tend to become oppressive. They use their coercive capacity to force people under their jurisdiction to think alike and stick together by force, as if that would make them a nation people. Coercion does not induce an enduring allegiance or a meaningful sense of citizenship or nationhood. No matter how strong and stable authoritarian regimes may appear, they remain vulnerable to intellectual dissension, internal dissension, and external manipulation and threats because of their weak social base. The regular involvement of citizens in the political process, directly and through the various groups or collectives with which they associate, would strengthen the government's social base. Many factors influence the formation of such an environment. I would like to emphasize only two here. Experience as one, and the ability to imagine reasonably inclusive and adaptable notions of citizenship as opposed to rigid and militant projects of nationhood. These help overcome the problems. Building institutions that enable effective representation of different groups and the negotiation and reconciliation of their differences takes time. It is a learning process through ups and downs, crises and clashes. Ability to learn from experience and to imagine inclusion helps overcome some of the problems that becoming a nation people, an effective state with strong social base, involves. Some countries are prepared to deal with the challenge better than others. I believe Lebanon has had the potential to do better than most. We tend to see the flaws and failures of the Lebanese, but overlook their considerable experience in participatory politics and building durable institutions, including the judiciary and the representative assembly. The roots of these practices and institutions go back to the Mutasarrafiyya days, 1861 to 1920, and even deeper in certain respects. One can argue, as I did in my book, of course, this Professor Engin did in his book on the Mutasarrafiyya of Mount Lebanon, and that the Mount Lebanese were prepared to have a state of their own as early as 1920. They even developed an idea of Lebanon that could accommodate the sensibilities of religiously diverse population, help cultivate a shared sense of destiny, and hence serve as a uniting collective ideal and identity. Here we need to make the distinction between this idea of Lebanon, an ideal, and the concept of Lebanon that informed the Maronite Church and certain mostly Maronite Lebanese intellectuals. A religious sense of nationhood nourished the Maronite concept of Lebanon. Belief in the cultural and moral superiority of Maronites was its basic premise, along with fear and suspicion of Muslims. The raison d'etre of Lebanon's government was the protection and further development of Christians in general, the Maronites in particular, for many, though not all, of the Maronite clergy. They believed it was incumbent upon the church to see to it that the government never lost sight of this fundamental responsibility. The essentially exclusivist nature of this Maronitist idea of Lebanon prevented its broad appeal despite the growing influence and power of the Maronite Church. Imagining an inclusive concept of Lebanon became possible when consociational system of governance took form in Mount Lebanon, encouraging cooperation and dialogue across denominational lines. Furthermore, a group of politicians, including and even led by several relatively young and liberal-minded Maronites, strove to undermine the political influence of the Maronite Church, with some success. A growing number of Lebanese political leaders and their constituencies recognized the advantages of sorting out their differences and pursuing their interests through the political system. Relative prosperity of Mount Lebanon and Beirut as well facilitated cooperation and the imagination of an inclusive concept of Lebanon. The hardships that the Lebanese suffered in the mountains and its vicinity, including Beirut, during the Great War, under the harsh martial rule of Ottoman commanders, enhanced the Lebanese's appreciation for self-government and the advantages that accrued from it. This appreciation, too, increased the appeal of the idea of Lebanon as a shared homeland. A quasi-nationalistic historical vision even developed, making use of Maronitist themes sometimes, but also expanding and neutralizing the Maronitist idea of Lebanon. One could now imagine Lebanon as the successor of ancient Phoenicia, and the land of refuge where communities of diverse beliefs peacefully coexisted. Lebanese publications, sponsored by the Mutasarrifiyya, government and cultural societies, proudly emphasize the geographical and historical uniqueness of Mount Lebanon and its vicinity, definitely including Beirut. The Druze, as well, played a prominent role in this history. The great Druze Emir Fakhreddin Mahdathani II emerged as the first leader to have united this land politically in recent memory. This inclusive Lebanonism was not the only nationalist vision and project in circulation among the Lebanese in the aftermath of the Great War. The commitment to the idea of a Christian Maronite Lebanon certainly persisted, sometimes overlapping with interconfessional visions of Lebanon. Syrian nationalism as well had its appeal, as did Nesson's pan-Arabist positions. Nevertheless, Lebanonism deserves special attention because it was not merely an intellectual construct, though its intellectual construction certainly deserves attention. It has a basis in 50-odd years of political experience gained in building a territorial government that enjoyed considerable popular support. This experience prepared the ground for the emergence and reception of a broad supra-communal vision of Lebanon. It was in the light of the same experience that a good majority of the elected representatives of the Lebanese bid for independence in 1918-1920, emphasizing the proven ability of the Lebanese to live in peace with themselves and with their neighbors. The victors of the Great War, however, decided to put Lebanon under French mandate. The French authorities charged the elected representatives of Lebanon who opposed them with treason and exile. Instead, they, i.e. the mandate power of the French mandate, recognized the Maronite Church as the true representative of Lebanon. Nevertheless, the inclusive idea of Lebanon persisted, as well as the influence of the Mutasarrifiyya experience and institutions. The National Pact of 1943 reflects this influence. One can argue as well that the same experience and the inclusive concept of Lebanon, as supplemented by additional experience and elaboration since 1920, continued to inspire the Lebanese through the clashes of 1958 and even the Civil War of 1975 through 1989. I hope it is still of some value, for a good, inclusive idea of nationhood matters in building and maintaining social peace. The Druze constituted a fundamental component of Mount Lebanon's population, and the Mutasarrifiyya regime recognized this significance. Although the Druze constituted about 12% of the population, they paid 21 to 24% of the total taxes based on the land they owned over or controlled over. They had an allotment of key positions in the mountain's fledgling governance system from the beginning. However, the Druze entered this stage of history in a very disadvantaged position. They paid a heavy price for the role they played in the events of 1860. One does not need to elaborate on these incidents before such a well-informed and distinguished audience, and when there are several excellent studies on them. One of the best is by my dear colleague Leila Gomez, the work entitled An Occasion for War, Civil Conflict in Lebanon and Damascus in 1860. The work is published in 1994. It should suffice here to mention that the Maronite clergy provoked the incidents, but the Druze gained the upper hand quickly, demonstrating their ability to act in unison. They attacked not only the Maronites, but other Christians as well, and with such vengeance that left behind a tragic number dead and wounded bodies, refugees, and destroyed property. The Druze leaders were put on harsh trial for this consequence and condemned to heavy sentences of imprisonment and payment of huge reparations. The Maronite Church took advantage of this development to strengthen its position and to expand the lands under its control. The Druze did not begin to recover until the governorships of Rustum and Vasabasha in 1873, 1883, and 1883, 1893, respectively, for 92. These governors were concerned that the Maronite Church had acquired disproportionate influence in the affairs of Mount Lebanon, with consequences that undermined Ottoman interests and could not be reconciled with normal practices of good governance. Thus, the Druze leadership became actively involved in the mountain's governance, judiciary, and security forces. As indicated earlier, the logic of the administrative structure of the mountain encouraged cooperation and allegiances among elected and appointed officials across communal lines. Consequently, the Druze leadership and functionaries interacted with colleagues from other communities while becoming embroiled in factional struggles that similarly crisscrossed communal lines. These intersectarian relationships were normal practice among the notables of the region, including the mountain and Beirut, in earlier times as well. Even when the intensification of intersectarian conflicts rigidified communal boundaries in the mid-19th century, communal leaders appear to have maintained some dialogue. However, such cross-sectarian relations now happen in an increasingly institutionalized and complex environment under the new regime in Mount Lebanon. Significant changes influenced all aspects of life in the same period. The growing number of government and missionary schools, great improvements in the means of transportation and communication, better health services, and now new economic opportunities combined with quite positive changes in the government as well as the judiciary to alter lives and introduce new perspectives in the mountain as well as the movement with which it became increasingly integrated. A glance at the performance of a few Druze players on this exciting new stage of history should provide some idea about the changes and challenges that affected the Lebanese in general and the elite Druze families in particular. Mustafa Aslem, born 1848-49, died 1915, was a Druze leader whom Rustum Pasha chose to appoint to the district governorship of Shum, a position reserved for the Druze. The appointment in 1873 was done in place of the mild-mannered Mehmed Aslem so as to strengthen the place of the Druze in the mountains administration. Mustafa ran Shum with a heavy hand, and with the mentality of a provincial power magnate. He demanded absolute obedience from his clan and his subordinates. Lebanon was clearly changing, however. The complaints against him obliged Vasabasha to dismiss him and to appoint Yushubwad in this place. Mustafa joined the conservative camp of the Maronite peasants, Maronite parents, and the Greek Orthodox queens, in addition to appealing to his friends and protectors in Istanbul for help to get his position back. He succeeded when a new government was appointed to Lebanon, partly due to the lobbying of the conservative alliance to which Mustafa belonged. Again, however, his autocratic style of governance invited reactions and alienated younger generations, including those from the Arslan clan. Mustafa's main concern appears to have been to strengthen the position of the Afghans in Lebanese politics and to maintain his dominance among the Afghans at this stage, and for most of his career, for that matter. He pledged loyalty to the Ottoman state on several occasions, and probably meant it. But on other occasions, he threatened the Ottoman authorities to compromise his loyalty if they invited his duty. He realized that he had to form alliances with other actors in the mountain if his threats were to carry weight. He chose to ally himself with conservative landed interests, including the Maronite Church, the largest landholder in the mountain. The need to operate in a new institutional setting and changing political as well as cultural environment seems to have changed once Mustafa in time, however. The volatility of the political environment after Abdul Hamid II's fall evidently worried him about the future. He brought the Druze leaders, especially the Jumbats and the Islams, together in a series of meetings in 1909 and 1910, so that they reconciled their differences, reinforced solidarity, and prepared for the developments that could well upset the order established in Lebanon and jeopardize the position of the Druze. One of the incidents that shows how certain changes in the mountain disoriented Mustafa and his cohort of elders involves a marriage issue. Mustafa had made arrangements to marry his elder son, Ali, to a second cousin, Najda, daughter of Khalid's. However, she refused to marry Mustafa's son, apparently because she could not relate well to him, and had definitely fallen in love with another cousin, Amin Majid Islam, grandson of Mehdi, Mustafa's predecessor in the district governorship of Shuf. Najda was educated in a missionary school, and so were Amin Majid and Mustafa's two younger sons, but not Arif. Mustafa was furious about Najda's desire to marry Amin Majid instead of Arif. Najda's father agreed not with his daughter, but with his powerful cousin. Mustafa pressured Najda into obeying the will of her elders. She collapsed mentally and was taken to Istanbul for long treatment. Mustafa put pressure on Amin Majid as well and forced him to leave that body. Amin Majid Islam was an interesting person in his own right. His life reflects the effects of changes taking place in the mountain on the younger generation of Amin's families. He was a journalist, an aspiring writer interested in new ideas, including women's rights. In fact, he wrote an article on women and their influence in society in the days he was courting Najda. When Mustafa literally chased him out of Lebanon, he joined the young Ottoman circles in Paris and briefly established a paper, Kashf al-Qitar, unveiling the veils. Sultan Abdul Hamid II's policy of co-opting opposition and the intervention of the governor of Mount Lebanon on his behalf enabled Amin to enter Ottoman diplomatic corps. He served in Bordeaux, Brussels, and Paris before the Unionists appointed him as the Ottoman chargé d'affaires in Argentine in 1910. He became increasingly critical of the Unionist government, however, and was dismissed from his position in 1915. He did not return to Lebanon even after the Great War. He stayed in Argentine, working as a journalist, a publisher, helping his compatriots from former Ottoman territories in legal matters and advocating the independence of Lebanon and Syria until his death in 1943. A similar conflict between the old and the young, so to speak, emerged among the Taqiyyideens, a family of qadis and religious scholars, Qalat. The dispute involved the trusteeship of a family endowment, Waqf, that was intended to support the Druze praying board, Hanwen. The case kindled a parallel dispute about the appropriate venue of the settlement of legal disputes related to Druze endowments and other procedure matters. The Druze parties, who came from among the Akar, had functions similar to those of regular parties and deputy parties in the past. They heard the Wakf cases and all kinds of other legal disputes, and not only for the Druze. New laws kept shifting the duties of the old party courts to the new regular courts in Nizamiya. The same laws, however, enhanced the legal autonomy of non-Muslim communities. Thus, the religious leaders won the authority to hear cases related to endowments serving their communities, in addition to cases related to family and inheritance issues. Rustam Pasha had encouraged the Druze to become better organized in the management of their religious affairs back in the early 1870s. The Druze leadership designated not one, but two Druze sheikhs of wisdom, Sheikh Hakim, to hear the appeals against the decisions of the Qadi and to represent the community. Thus, Abdul Ghaffar al-Din, who lost the trusteeship of the Waqf to Milhat al-Din under accusations of corruption, took his case up to the two sheikhs of Abu in 1909. In case you're interested, they were Muhammad Ahmed al-Baqlin and Muhammad Qadi al-Shaydi. When the two sheikhs set a date to review the case, however, Amin Taqiyuddin, a lawyer, trained in new schools and defending Milhan, challenged the sheikh's authority and legal competence. He argued that the regular civil courts of the state should hear such disputes according to the rational law of the land as opposed to archaic customs. Amin claimed he represented the progressive voice of the Druze and publicized his position. Amin's appeal, however, did not find a strong following. As the weaknesses of the Ottoman state became increasingly evident, and the secular Druze chiefs reconciled their differences to reinforce their communal solidarity, the sheikhs of Abu had their way. Amin himself revised his opposition to the formation of a religious appellate court down to technical concerns about its composition and the scope of its authority. His actions and arguments, however, bore fruit nonetheless. The two sheikhs felt obliged to better define the duties of their office and the distinction of the Druze as a community so as to justify the judicial autonomy and privileges that would give them parity, say with Christian clergy. The Druze religious leaders acquired better defined and expanded judicial responsibilities, and the Druze Waqfs came under their control. They were also able to provide a clear structure to Druze religious functions and to the responsibilities of Druze religious functionaries, including the Mehta judges. In a sense, the Druze too acquired the church, although not as bureaucratic as a real church. After all, the Druze faith has its origins in Islam. Despite their small numbers, the Druze have been able to maintain their existence by closing in their ranks against real or perceived threats in the past. The physical isolation of the areas in which they lived had helped them in this regard. Mount Lebanon and its vicinity, the area that eventually became the modern Republic of Lebanon, however, had become highly developed, fully integrated into world markets, strategically important, and a coveted prize for rival European powers in the very likely event of the dissolution of the Ottoman Empire. Survival in this new environment necessitated new responses. Military prowess had proved of little help to the Druze in 1860, but they had been able to carve a respectable niche for themselves in the spatial machine established in Mount Lebanon since then, with some support from Istanbul. So they could now take positions for Lebanon and speak for better as the title, the English translation of Emerging Worlds, that it was the only sense. Thank you. I will now give the floor back to Professor for his recent remarks. We will open the floor for any comments, questions, and answers. There will be a wireless microphone around the room. Professor Akarli is very happy to take it.